So there I was, minding my own business on Super Bowl Sunday, enjoying a nice hike on Camelback Mountain with the trail all to myself, and listening to the latest episode of the First Touch podcast. Just as I was getting buzzed by the flyover from the game, T-Bates ruined my perfectly good mood with the most asinine take I have ever heard on that show.
So they would pass the ball.
I just don't see teamwork as an EU play style. I just don't see that. Because there's so many EU teams that don't do that. Even the best. When BDS were the best, were they using teamwork or were they just using monkey move?
Are you using monkey move?
Credit to Bates, that crazy take and the ensuing conversation fired me up and carried me right up that mountain. But I've been stewing on this while I've been working on some new analysis tools, and I just cannot let it go. We have the numbers to show the styles that these teams play in, and I'm going to show them to you right now. For some context of what led up to this wild conversation, the guys on the podcast were talking about the prevalence of good South American teams and European players in North America, and answering the question, is North America still the best in their own region? And then Nolly brought up G2 and how they have a more European playstyle, while other teams in North America are completely different. Bates brushed the comment aside and started talking about how Geng have assimilated into the NA playstyle, to the virulent disagreement of Nolly, who rightfully claims that they have a much more European playstyle, because two-thirds of the team is European, and they carried that style with them across the pond. And then, we got the comment.
When BDS were the best, were they using teamwork or were they using monkey move?
Are you using monkey move? Oh my god.
What are you talking about?
I uploaded a whole movie about Team BDS's playstyle evolution about a month ago, so go watch that if you haven't already. Here are the cliff notes that you need for right now. Yes, Team BDS were a passing team, especially after they picked up Seiko. Monkey Moon and Seiko passed the ball back and forth like there was no other way to play the game, and extra filled in the gaps and facilitated a lot of plays all around the field. At their prime, Team BDS had around 0.8 assists per goal per player per game. When they faltered at the London Major and then the fall split of this season, there was a clear decrease in the number of assists despite putting the same amount of shots on the net, meaning they were passing a lot less and playing more of an NA playstyle, as Nolly called it. One player solo plays, and then another, and then another, and it's very disjointed and individual a lot of the time. So what are the EU and NA playstyles that the guys on the podcast are talking about? Let's dig into a topic called Systems-Based Rocket League, the next tactical revolution that we're seeing right now at the highest levels of the esport. If you want a super detailed rundown of the concept, check out my friend JC Hammer, who has put in the hard work of defining everything I'm about to show you. There are two primary rotation systems that professional Rocket League teams are using right now, whether they realize it or not. Cover 2 and Stacked, the EU and NA playstyles, respectively. Here's the very basic rundown. With a stacked playstyle, a team generally follows a pattern of solo plays and follow-ups. Think Beast Mode from version 1, air dribbling across the field and shooting a flip reset at the opponent's defended net, and Calm going for a follow-up with Torment following that, while Beast Mode collects boost and prepares for the result of Torment's play. With a cover 2 rotation, a team is essentially playing defense from the midfield, keeping the ball in the opponent's half and starving them of their boost, momentum, and cohesion by strategically positioning themselves to challenge any attempts to clear or possess the ball. To the untrained eye, the chaos that is professional Rocket League might all look the same, but these styles are quite different from each other. Now let's visualize what these playstyles look like in a simple graph. If you're new here, these graphs are generated by a machine learning algorithm that I wrote along with some vector math magic. The closer the point on a player's shape is to each playstyle on the graph, the closer to the average of that style the player is. The shape of each player gives you a pretty good idea of their tendencies over a period of multiple games. I'll go over what each defined playstyle means as they become relevant. More info is available in the Reddit post linked in the description. Here's Team BDS's playstyle graph for the duration of the 21-22 season that Seiko was on the team. They generally played cover 2, and they pioneered what the EU playstyle looks like today. Monkey Moon was generally the most aggressive, favoring the first man in striker roles. Seiko was very similar but had a higher tendency for second man, meaning he passed the ball around and had a lot of assists. Extra came up less in the frontline styles of striker and first man and played more of the second man in anchor roles. Everything on the pitch that facilitates success but doesn't directly get you goals on the scoreboard. Also notice that they all share equally in the burden of third man, all playing their part in the goal line defense when they have to. Take a closer look, and you'll see that the third man role is not actually super represented on this team. The third man is a save-heavy role in the model used to create these graphs, and Team BDS didn't have many of those because their defense was played in the midfield, not on the goal line. For contrast, here's NRG's graph for the whole RLCSX season. Remember, they thrashed nearly all of their opponents for over a year with this style until a sudden drop-off in performance at the Los Angeles Major. I made a more detailed video about that, if you're interested. You can pretty clearly see the marching order of the team here. Justin first, Garrett second, and Squishy third. Justin solo plays, Garrett follows up, Squishy follows up, and repeat. Justin played little defense, leaving that task up to Garrett and Squishy. Those two also got heavy second man roles in the graph because they would feed Justin the ball on quick counterattacks and pass to him for the finish after they scrambled the opposing team's defense. Despite energy falling off of the top, their stack playstyle is cemented in the meta of North America. And to this day, people talk a lot more about the individual skill of players in the region rather than the cohesiveness of their teams. If a good team starts to do poorly in the region, the conversation is almost never about what the team could do differently in the field. It's way too commonly about removing the most defensive player and replacing them with the most offensive player from another team, letting their chemistry from rank 2s do the rest. With that out of the way, let's check on the claims that T-Bates made in this section of First Touch. Number 1. G2 does not play like an EU team. Check on their graph so far from the season, and sure enough, it looks like they do play like one. They're actually a pretty unique case and don't have graphs that look completely like NA or EU. They do, however, run a more cover 2 than a stack style, so they are more on the side of EU. Maybe even more so than Gen G. Which leads into number 2. Has Gen G adopted the NA playstyle? Absolutely not. Just watching them play with a close eye, you can see how well they run the cover 2 system. Until FaZe were finally able to take the final series in the NA Winter Cup, no one stood a chance against it once the group stages were over and the brackets started. The graph reaffirms that they're playing that style. Jack is predictably a little more forward than Chronic, but the team has every single player in that assist-heavy second man role. They're also playing more third man than Team BDS did in their prime last season, but that's mostly a consequence of NA teams getting better at getting shots on the net against this style. Not effective shots, but shots nonetheless. For reference, here's the playstyle graph for FaZe so far this season. It looks exactly like the stack playstyle that NRG made so famous and cemented into the North American meta, and they are currently the best at it. Number 3. Karmine Corp don't play like Gen G or G2. False. They play almost exactly like G2. Just look at the graph. Batira is a little less on the anchor, second man, and third man roles than his teammates, but they're all contributing pretty equally on striking and first man. The latter two are again weighted heavily in high assist roles. Nulli and Itachi are both playing the same facilitating type of role for their respective teams, covering that midfield defense, enabling the sharp offense of their teammates, and putting on quite the offensive show themselves sometimes. Here are the playstyle graphs for the top 4 teams in each region as of the writing of this video. It's not completely binary like portrayed on the podcast, and the graphs aren't a perfect representation of what each rotation system looks like all of the time, but the difference between the regions is pretty clear. European teams in G2 generally have tight cohesion of the two most offensive players with a heavy team emphasis on the second man role, and North American teams have all three players covering pretty different tendencies with a little bit of overlap. So that's it. T-Bates is wrong, and those are the numbers to prove it. And we don't need to talk about the rest of what they discussed, like who plays the prettiest or the most physical, like that's not my wheelhouse. If my numbers aren't convincing enough, go back and watch the games for yourselves with this newfound knowledge that you have about systems-based Rocket League. Go watch JC's videos on the formations and be an early adopter of the next big meta shift that's going on right now in Rocket League esports. And of course, go watch the First Touch podcast. They put on a great show and they're super entertaining. And I will see you in the next video, hopefully with some new stuff. See ya.
Dancing with devils is dangerous. I need some true intense, it's not plastic. It feel like every word building up my casket. Swim through the mentions, blocking up the traffic, and I ain't wanna talk.